All right, you hear me?
Yes.
All right, welcome to everybody who's on here already. Should be a pretty good talk today. We have about 40 people in here, and we're going to give it a couple, we can give it another minute or so, try to get some more people in before we get started. So grab a glass of water or anything, and we'll be with you shortly. In the cone of silence here. Okay, well, we gave that about a minute, almost a minute exactly, and I think we're going to get started here. So again, welcome to the J70 Spring 2021 webinar by Quantum Sales. It's been a long winter, as everybody knows, but we've gotten some good sailing in and learned a lot of good things along the way, and that's why we want to do this and share as much of the information as we know. And giving it to everyone out there. So I just want to introduce the team that I have with me today. I have Kris Werner and Cam Appleton. Kris is he owns the loft here in Rochester, New York, and Cam works out of the Quantum Sales Newport loft. Both recently involved in the J70 sailing. Cam did the Bacardi Cup with Bob Hughes. And Kris Werner has been sailing with David Ginetti on Variad as a trimmer for the last year. So pretty excited to have these guys with me because I'm sure all of you don't want to hear me talk the entire time. So it'll be good to hand this off to the times. You know, it's been pretty fun seeing the J70 class. As you can see from this slide here, what we're going to talk about in the beginning and the state of the class and where it's been, you know, where it's come from, where it's going, how I feel about it. And it's just been really awesome to see grow. Right now, the 70 class, you know, obviously we all had a hiatus in the last year here, but all winter long in the U.S. here and down south in Miami and Tampa, we've been sailing 25 plus boats. About 2 to 3 times a month. So I think that's a really good sign that the class wants to be sailing and continues to grow. As we all become a little healthier and a little more interested in sailing again, it looks like the next few events between Charleston Race Week and Annapolis Nude and even the J70 North Americans are gonna have 40 and then 40 boats, and then in North Americans, it looks like 60 to 70 boats. So the class, again, is strong, it's going strong, and the people in it are absolutely great. Everyone's willing to share and grow together. You know, Ed Furry with Sail 22 has been the reason that we've been able to sail all winter using Marksat bots and stuff like that. So he's really taken the reins and getting coaches for each event for people who usually do that. So it's been really, really fun that way. And I think a lot of people got a lot out of this winter. In a way, it was a break from normal sailing, but I think we may have learned more by doing it this way than we have in the past. So kudos to Ed on that. Really, really happy with what we did this winter. You know, speaking of that, winter racing opportunities, the winter racing scene in the U.S. is huge. And I think as time goes on and we get into next September, November, December area where the regattas start to pick up again, I encourage everybody to try to get down south for a couple different events. There's rumors of a Key West event starting up for the J70s. You have Miami already and Tampa, and Miami and Tampa have been great. You know, normally 50 to 60 boats at each event. And that's a good sign for the class that it's not going away anytime soon. So in our upcoming events, like I said, we have Charleston Race Week in a week here. We have Annapolis Nude, which is a week and a half, 2 weeks before the North Americans, which are also in Annapolis. So if you're planning on doing North Americans, you know, Charleston's great to be around other boats, but I would say Annapolis Nude is where you're going to want to be to learn the crazy current, the up and down breeze that we get there. And yeah, it'll be really good to get 40 to 60 boats out again. So we're going to move on to the next slide here and start talking about the team. You know, one thing that I could say that us at Quant gained out of COVID was to really, you know, you got to look at positive things. It's been a tough year, and we're looking at the positive side of things. We got to take a break in real racing and really go back and hone in on who we want to be part of our team for the J70 and how we're going to get up, you know, up to snuff with everybody else and make sure that we're a competing factor in this group and in this fleet. And the J70 Quantum team that was put together by us here really is second to none, and it was just amazing to work with them. We have Adrian DeBeloy out of France, Kris Werner here in Rochester, Scott Nixon in Annapolis, Victor Marino in Spain, George Szabo and Mark Reynolds, both in San Diego, Carlo Fracaselli, he's in Italy, and Fernando Salen, he's in Spain as well. The reason I want to bring up these guys is they're the real reason that we got to where we are this year with our sales, with our teams, with our program, and I want to give kudos where kudos is deserved. And it's just amazing. There's not often where you're going to get this group, this amount of people together, and all of them start to agree with each other. And about 6 months ago, everyone agreed on what we were doing and the designs of the sails. And I mean, that was amazing. So we're really happy with it. We want to say thank you to them. And for all of you out there, this is, you know, any of these guys, you can email, call at any time, and they've got the information for you that we've learned in the last year. So I just want to say thank you to them. And if you guys have any questions, please feel free to reach out to them. You know, before we get started with the next slide, that's another thing. There is a question bar up top right, and that will be – That can be used this entire time while we go through this, because, you know, as much as I want to talk about our sales we've done and bring these guys in as team members, I also want you guys to ask as many questions as you can, and I will take breaks as we go along to try to answer them. Cam, myself, or Kris, I'll have them jump in if I can't answer it. So just feel free to answer any questions you can or ask questions you can, okay? So that's the team, and now we're on to the new sails. We're going to start off with our mainsail. Like I said, it's been a really good year for us to really hone in on our designs and how we're going to do things going forward. And, you know, I talked about the team already, just an amazing team and the resources that we have to use right now. I've learned a ton from this group and, you know, wouldn't be where I am today without them. So, with the new sails, we have the new mainsail, the CM1. All of our sails, when I try to name them, I put in the designer's first name or last name in front of him. And Carlo is one that came up with the mainsail and the jib. You know, in the past, we've had pretty full sails and, you know, it was really good for light and lumpy. But as we developed our sails and our programs, we realized that, you know, the faster shapes are getting flatter. And what does this entail? And what do we want to work on here? And so my big thought was that, well, I want to see a twistier sail, a flatter sail up top. This is allowing us to really make it easier on the rig tuning, because we really know that, you know, with it not being such a full sail, we know how to kind of match our lowers and our uppers up now. And it being flatter just makes it easier to turn. The visual tuning is there for a sail compared to a fuller sail, in my opinion. So what has changed? We've gone twistier with the mainsail. We've gone flatter with the mainsail. Conditions, mainsail, you know, we've used it in flat water at Davis Island, and we used it with the chop in Miami, anywhere from 4 knots to 25 knots. And so far it's performing well. So we're really, really happy with that. It's not much different than what everyone out there is used to set up. You know, you follow our tuning guide, and it seems to match up really, really well. You know, there's a couple of tricks that we'll get into later to help the tuning guide out. The tuning guide is a guide, so it's a good start, but there are some tricks that we can help you with going forward, really with any sail and sail maker, you know, sail company. There are guides, and then there are a couple of tricks that we can help you with, and we'll get into those later. So we're going to move on to the jib now. Oh, we're still in the main, but we'll be at the jib here. So the CF2 head sail here, gauge changes, all that good stuff. The one thing that I've noticed in the past from Quantum is they've done a really good job at making sail as fast as possible, but one thing you had to be really keen on was the tuning and the headstay setup and all that. And I think when Carlo and all discussed what had to happen to our jib, is it had to be more forgiving. You know, the best guys in the world can go out there and sail any sail they want, but what's going to happen with the guys in the middle or the guys trying to achieve their goals? We have to come up with a more forgiving jib. So what went with a fuller entry on this sail, slightly fuller than our past jibs. This is really nice because when you're at speed, you can sail on the inside of the jib with the telltale sticking straight up and not lose flow over the sail, not lose flow over your foils. And really, it's a forgiving setup that way. We also changed the clew height. We raised the clew height substantially. And we'll get into that a little later with what that has done to our rig tune. And, you know, the last thing we changed, we used to have a pretty full head. And this sail, comparatively to our sails in the past, is a slightly twistier top along with a flatter head as well. I mean, those both go hand in hand. But this is allowing us to in-haul pretty hard and not shut off the top, which is really key in this boat. I mean, we're going to have Kris touch on this, but the in-hauler has become a game changer in our VMG upwind. So that's really what has changed between our old sails and our new upwind sails. Obviously, the key words you keep hearing are flatter. So everything is flatter, and then everything is adjusted by our weather sheet and lure sheet on the jib, which really, really gives you some ranges to work with. So, you know, that's what's in our jib. And like I said, keep asking questions when you can. And this is a great picture here. Shows us in about 12 knots on the left. And, you know, it's showing how we're sailing with a flatter here, but that's because we're in flat water and a bit of breeze. So as the breeze comes down, the draft moves aft, but still keeping a good full entry there. You can see the top shape here being slightly flatter than our old setup. And the jib's trimmed pretty hard. So it's a good picture of what we're working with these days. And same picture on the right here, which is showing how much in-hauler we're using. This is a flat sea state. But at the same time, you know, we're going for a flat bottom here because of the sea state, and we're going for in hauler needed as well. So these are some of the things that we look at. These are pictures that we like to take every time we go sailing to critique ourselves off the water. And, you know, it's pretty good stuff. So as we're in the J70 jib, I'm going to bring in Kris Werner here. Kris was trimming this day. I remember it in Miami. And Kris, can you talk a little bit about what you've learned from where we started with our trimming to now, what we're doing with the jib? Because I know it's changed since you've been on the boat, which is excellent that you've learned all the way through. So Kris, why don't you take over a little bit about what you've learned about jib trim?
Yeah, thanks, Travis. So can you hear me all right? All right. So, I mean, one of the biggest things I think obviously has been a lot of what Travis talked about is the progression to just more and more in-hauling. So a big thing here, even in this picture, if you guys look at to the right there, you know, we still go, you know, even harder than that. There's still, you know, quite a bit more room of as far as range of in-haul that would even be beyond this. I think one of the biggest changes, at least when I had a J70 back when they first came out and sailed them a bunch and went through some different sails. And it was just it was in hauling, but it wasn't to the extent we're doing now. You know, the clues moved up higher to allow more in hauling. If you see in this picture here, you know, the reason being that way you have the deck, you know, the clue is going to be able to sweep the deck and get in closer. So that's been a big progression of the sails, becoming a bit flatter, being able to put the in-hauler on, and really doing so in a way that doesn't stall out your top telltale and lose the groove that you want. A big thing Travis talked about was being, you know, having a forgiving setup. So I think in what I've seen as a progression in the class is that as we go, you know, the earlier, some of the real top teams were in-hauling a bit more, but it was a very, very, very fine groove to be able to in-haul, you know, more than just a little bit. And I think the progression has been that the sails are developed, and especially our new jib, allowing you to be pretty aggressive with the in-haul and not, you know, and yet still get a great shape and not worry about constantly closing off the upper leech telltale and things of that nature. So that's my quick comment on that, Trav.
That's great. And I think, you know, what we're seeing, it's interesting with us, and we'll get into this a little later when we talk about where our cars are positioned and all that. But the sign of a forgiving jib is that our car placement isn't changing much. There's maybe two holes I have used in the last three events, and that's eight holes showing forward. And what we're doing is we're actually just playing the leeward or the weather sheet. So if I want more shape down low, and this picture on the right here is great to show this, that it's a little bit flat there. But if I was in a lumpier condition, I would just ease the leeward sheet, but keep the weather sheet on to where it is. And the shape changes for you, the top twists open a little bit. It's really, it's dynamic, but at the same time, it's like I said, we're going to use here is forgiving, because we're not having to move the car, you know, five, six different holes. It really, I can tell somebody, hey, I'm at car, you know, I'm at hole eight here. Why don't you guys go to hole eight? And then we know exactly where we want to set the jib up from there. So that's what we've been working with. We haven't had to change the car placement much. It's really been on leeward or weather sheet that's changed the shape for us. So that's a really good sign. We're going to get a little more into jib, and also the clue height plays into the rig factor as well. And we're going to get more into that as we go on, but I'm just getting through our sails here now. So we're going to move on to the spinnaker here. And this sail is brand new in January this year. There's not much new in cloth. We have Eric 650, as you see, and Dynacoat 75. I want to say, you know, I want to let everyone, I use Eric 650. There's reasons to use the other one. It's a, you know, Dynacoat 75 is a softer cloth. It is really good right out of the box. Might not last as long, but a pretty fast kite right out of the box. The Eric 650, which has gotten better and better over time, and we prefer it in a lot of the boats, this sail seems to not only last long, but the pumping you know, you're going downwind and you're pumping. For some reason, it seems to grip a little bit better as well. So pumping effect is better with the Eric 650. So usually I push a customer that way. The design change, our sales have always been pretty good in the upper range of, you know, planing and all that. We had a little bit of flatter, we were a little flatter on the head or the top half of the spinnaker. And we've changed that slightly to allow this spinnaker to rotate and to go into soak mode. I know for all of you who have been sailing J70s, you know that the biggest move is to be able to go low in this boat, even when you're planing. So having, you know, having a sail that's flat is great for the up, you know, great for planing, but having a sail that's more full and more forgiving and more able to rotate is allowing us to use the lazy plane longer, have better VMG, and at the same time, we're allowing ourselves to go to the wing slightly easier. So this whole sail has been developed in the last year, and now we're pretty happy with it, and we don't see us changing it for quite some time. I know sailing in Miami, we were able to go low when we were planing. We were able to go low when we were in displacement mode, and that was a big key to our success. And you know, I'm going to bring Kris in here again in a second, but we're looking at this picture. And I'm going to talk a little bit about downwind, and I love that this picture shows me moving my helm way too much, but that's okay, because what it's showing us here is instead of where we're used to Melges 24s and Melges 20s, where you're just constantly trying to heat up in big breeze to plane, this boat, we've found that with the fuller spinnaker, we are able to bear off in the puff, keep the main sheet in, and really kind of accelerate our down mode in our planing mode as well. So that's what I'm doing here is mostly working to get down in the puff. So it's something that the spinnaker has given us a chance to do finally, and we're pretty happy about it. So Kris, one more thing here from you on trimming downwind. Can you discuss like what you look at downwind? You know, how much are you easing? Do you like to curl more than one panel? Do you, and then kind of what you're looking for and how you're talking to the skipper, either whether it's displacement or planing conditions?
Yeah. So, I mean, I think in general, I always like to err, you know, maybe a touch on the, you know, making sure that you're always getting some decent curl. I think a little bit depends on the mode you're in. You know, if you're really uprange and the boat's really ripping, then I might be okay with living a little bit more on the forgiving side, a little bit more of a wink, if you will, just so that I'm not risking the boat, you know, tipping over or being a little too loaded. But I think the big thing I'm looking for is just constant, you know, I can't stress enough the communication with the skipper about what he's feeling in the helm. And so much, especially in the lighter breeze. In the bigger breeze, I think you as a trimmer, you can feel the boat a bit more. You know, most trimmers, if you've ever driven a boat or you understand sort of that feel in your seat, right, and trying to keep that steady heel angle, I think you can very much, you know, when the boat's really ripping downwind, you can feel that in a similar sense, so that can help you react to how aggressive you're going to trim the kite, right, in the sense that, you know, the boat's getting a little bit light and you might heat up a little bit and you might sort of like, you know, preemptively trim the kite in a little bit because you know the helm's going to, you know, the boat's going to head up and the helmsman's going to head up to try to get that speed or get back on the step again. So I think there's a lot of that feel is important uprange, to be feeling the boat as if you're a skipper, you know what I'm saying? In the sense of the heel angle and everything else. But yeah, I definitely just want to, you know, stress this spinnaker really has been one of the best I've encountered yet for a boat. As everybody knows, you're not going to find a single spin, you know, it's a single spinnaker, right? It's not going to excel in every condition. You're asking the sail to sail from 0 knots to 25 plus. So there's, you know, obviously some parts of the range where, you know, maybe someone else's spinnaker might be a little flatter and they're able to sail slightly hotter or something of that nature. But I really love this vinegar. I think it handles the whole range really, really well. I haven't seen any weaknesses in the sale yet.
Yeah, that's what's really good. You're talking about trimming styles, and you know, something that I learned over this year was I started trimming a little bit for Dave Giannetti at times, and you know, at one point I think Scott Nixon told me I didn't know how to trim, and he taught me how to do it and in his way. And you know, the biggest thing I could say for anybody, you know, through the ranges, displacement. Kris hit a good point. Make sure you're working that low mode as much as you can with displacement mode. And then when you're in this high mode, when a puff hits, we're easing. We're probably two panels curled so the boat doesn't wipe out. And when we want more power, we're just pulling the curl out. Those are the two things. It sounds so simple, but when you're in it, it's kind of hard to hit it right every single time. But if you remember, just like your main sheet, you're easing the kite and the puff, and you're trimming the kite back on when you hit a lull and trying to get powered up. I think those are two things that change the way we sail downwind pretty aggressively. So that's all good stuff on downwind. You know, as we go through this, guys, you know, bring on the questions for Kris and Cam here. We're going to get into what's changed in the tuning guide and tuning updates. But one thing I want to ask Cam Appleton here, this is your first time sailing a J70 at Bacardi in a long time. You sail with Bob Hughes, like I mentioned. And can you, you know, the first thing I want to talk about, ease of setup and you know, you following the tuning guide, and what made it easy for you to do well in that, you know, in the first couple of days there? You guys did great. Haven't sailed a boat in a long time. Is it just your skill, or, you know, were you helped out with some other stuff?
I think straight out of the bag, the sails were in really, really good from a point of view of just the balance and the shape. We stuck to the tuning guide, you know, and really used that as our base. And I think we went out there. We actually, Miami set up as a bit of a challenging event with it being so windy leading in through all the practice days leading into the event. So it didn't really give us much time to really go out and sail against anyone. We even line up with another boat until the start of the first race. So we were really pleased with just like you said, the balance, the entry in the jib, the forgiveness, and, you know, twist can often be, you know, your friend. And in heavy air, you're always looking to twist, and bumpy waves, you're looking to twist. And so just the way that those sails presented themselves to us straight out of the bag was really encouraging, and really gave us a platform to have a very high level to start off with. And so that side of things was really good for us. And then just after that, just going out and sailing and doing the basics and just setting up and just making sure you hit your settings and you do your processes correctly. You know, just touching on the spinnakers a little bit and downwind, I kind of look at it, you know, in the all-out planing modes is, you know, making sure your weight distribution is correct fore and aft, making sure you've got as much riding moment on the rail and having that side of things working for you. You know, you travel it down, your backstay becomes quite a key control, you know. Some trimmers like to be the ones that are going through big changes in backstay downwind based on your mode. Vang on and off, you know, using the vang as your heel control, using that, the main morph for your heel control is a way that I like to look at it. And your kite is your all-out power and moding and keeping the apparent as far forward as possible to drive you low. So, you know, if you're sheeting on the spinnaker to try and build speed, and you can be just behind on the main just to keep the heel under control so that the helmsman can really just keep that boat locked in. You know, those are some of the keys. And so use your controls, use everything you have, and use them through big ranges, I think is quite important. And having the person on the front controlling the vang and knowing what the goal is for the vang at that particular moment. So you kind of set some parameters and you know, really push the boat, push yourselves, and use everybody to the fullest on board.
we're going to go back here a little bit to why the J70 is such a great boat, in my opinion. When you talk about Melges 24s and stuff like that, you're really in the upwind stuff, you're using, you know, two people, a tactician and a driver. And in this boat, upwind and downwind, you're using the whole team. The whole team's weight has to be perfect. The whole team has to be discussing trim. The whole team has to be discussing tactics and where we want to be on the boat. And that's what's really been great. I think, Cam, you hit the nail on the head there when you talked about, you know, making sure crew weight is perfect and where you want to be in the boat, because this boat is really sensitive to crew weight. So I think as we go through this, we're going to go through a little bit of our setup and everything and what we look for. But that's some really good points, especially Cam, you not being in the boat that much, and then all of a sudden you realize how much that makes a difference. Really takes the whole team to do pretty well in this boat. So, you know, we went over some of the stuff here and control lines and lead positions on nails. But I want to talk, you know, what do we do? What do we do at the dock? You know, we're talking about general boat setup. What are the couple of things that our teams run through? And, you know, I know that there's 100 ways to skin a cat, but I'll give you a little insight into what we do before we're going out on the water each day. And as it pertains to where we've gotten to our tuning guide and how we've gotten there. So general boat setup, you know, we do all the normal things. We set up our rig at base. We caliper, we take calipers, measurements on our upper shrouds, our cap shrouds and our D1s. We take caliper numbers when the rig's centered so that we can always get back to that base number. We do all of this at the dock. And then we even take caliper numbers on our head setting to make sure we can always remember where that is. You know, we don't mess around too much with head stay. We follow our guide, which is at 58 inches on the swing measurement. But we also take calipers of that in case we do want to take a day of testing and see if anything else works. So, you know, at the day, we really hone in on our rig setting. So when we're out in the water, we don't need to bring our loose gauge. We know exactly how many turns we're going up and down on the rig. And if we feel like we get out of whack, we have our calipers and we quickly go back to base, make sure we're happy there, and then go back to the rig tune that we do. A couple things in a J70 that are pertinent to doing well and pertinent to the boat are making sure that you have everything marked on the boat. You have your jib trim sheets, jib trim marks on the deck. You know, I think we have 1 through 14, and we probably use, you know, 3 or 4 of those all together, but we have 1 through 14 in case things get weird. And then we have marks at our cabin tops that show a sheeting angle for the weather sheet, 9 degrees, 10 degrees, and 11 degrees. And so we get those by measuring back from the bow of the boat to the center line of the boat and then out. And when, you know, if you guys have questions on how to do that, it's really hard to explain right here, but I have a whole notebook that'll help everybody set up those degree heating angles. But those are for our weather sheet. So 9 degrees being the innermost that we're at, 10 degrees and 11 degrees. Our jib probably lives between 10 and 9 most of the time. And, you know, maybe in really super heavy conditions, we're at 11 degrees, and super light, we might be outside the cabin top as well. So those are some settings that we write down right away on the deck to kind of give us a way to where our sheet is. And then once we hone all that in and understand where we want to be, we're just placing the jib to its numbers on the sheeting, on the trim marks. And we hit those out of the tack every single time, and it makes it easy for the trimmer to know exactly where they want to be. So that's something that we really want to get right. For our jib trim marks, we measure back from the bow as well. You know, I'm not sure what that number is, but back, it's something like 95 inches or 100 inches, something like that. Back, that's our number one spot, and then we start going back from there. So sure that you do it evenly on either side is more important than what my number might be. so that you can repeat your settings each time. You know, here, J70 upwind trim right here. These are our angles here on the cabin top. We have the middle one is your 10 degree and your one is your 9 degree. And that shows us where we are on our inhaler. And you can't see here, but we do have a whipping line on our sheeting mark that we can see through our, sorry, I have my daughter here. Hold on 2 seconds. Bye. Okay, there you go. Life in COVID with the family at home all the time. So anyways, so you can see this pretty well with the sheeting marks. And on our jib sheets, we have a whipping mark in there, and that will show us where we are, you know, because it's pretty hard to see those sheeting marks when you're going upwind to leeward. But if you have the whipping mark, you can see it coming out of the block, and that really helps us as well. And here is Kris. He's got his hands in here, and this shows that for quantums, we use our jib track. Our jib cars are measured forward. So one being the first hole forward in front of the screw. Some of these tracks have two holes in front of the screw. That's why I always use the first hole in front of the most furthest screw. And we measure back from there. Our normal range is 8 holes showing forward, sometimes 8.5. Super breezy, 9. And that's where we're living with it right now, and adjusting the lured or weather sheet as need be. So, you know, pretty simple setup. We have a lot of guides on our boat to let us know where we are. And, you know, that's what we're doing with our leads. As it says here in our slideshow, the flat water versus the lump. Flat water, you know, you can have more straight leeches, which mean tighter sheeting angles on or tighter sheet on the leeward side, along with a tight weather sheet. And then as it gets lumpier, we're just easing that leeward sheet and keeping the weather sheet on. This is putting shape down low and it's twisting off up top. So really versatile, pretty easy to do. And I think for anybody that has other sails, I think this is pretty much the way you're all doing it as well. You know, that it's across the board, everybody's using the same sail on that. So on to the next slide here. Tuning and tuning guide. In our website right now, we have a new tuning guide up, ready to go. We're going to move on to the next slide that has our quick tune chart for you. And this, you know, this is what Cam was talking about, how he looked at the chart, just followed the guide. And something that I want to talk about for us, at least, you know, this goes back to why the clue is so high and everything. We found out a lot about the headstay and how long it can be and why more rake is good. So initially, more rake for us, what does that do to a boat? Well, it gets the center of effort kind of closer together so that you're going to evolve into having more helm as a driver, weather helm that is. You know, the more forward the rake is in the boat, the more neutral to leeward helm you'll end up getting. The further aft the rake is, you know, you're going to end up with a little bit more weather helm, slightly neutral helm at times as well. So we started about 2 years ago at 55 and three quarters on the rake measurement. As we started to get into it a little bit, we realized that dropping the rake back had two effects. One, it might be easier to drive, give the driver a little more feeling. Two, with the higher clue, we could drop the rake back and the deck sweep and the way the jib was trimmed was all lining up properly. And three, the way the mast butt is angled in the mast step, actually, this is crazy, but it as you rake back, the way that the mast butt is sitting in there, it's inducing more pre-bend. So getting our mast to bend uniformly throughout the mast. And that's something when we were raked further forward at that 55 and a half, 56, we'd see a big bend up top, not much down low, or vice versa. And as we came back, everything started to uniformly bend. And the boat the feeling of the boat was easier to keep in a groove. So as of right now, all of us are sailing at 58 inches with quantums. This is to the bottom pin on the furler, the very bottom pin. So I know some of you guys are measuring to the top pin, but that's where we're measuring it to. So that was a really good find on our part. And we're pretty happy with that rake number. We've tried to go longer, but with our sail right now, it won't trim in as hard as we'd like it to if we go to like 58.5. So we really like this number. And then if you look at our quick tune chart, which Quantum Sails just posted down here that you can take a look at, it's showing the range that we're working through and where our base is, where we're talking about. I know a lot of you that have Norths or have Doyles, your base starts lower, but it's about the same wind ranges. We're just, you know, we're just starting our base at 10 to 12 knots. You know, we follow the base, we follow the rig tune pretty critically. We follow it when you're going down in light air. We leave, we don't do anything crazy. We follow the guide like to the T, under base. And over base, it gets a little different. Right now you can see our first step up is 2 to 1. We're actually starting to go 1 to 1 ratios on our rig settings. This is keeping the bottom of the mast a little straighter for us so that we have a little depth in the main down low and are able to play the vang when needed. We seem to really like adding an extra turn to the lowers to this guide. That's just a little trick that we have. The guide will set up pretty easily and pretty nicely, but in bigger breeze and bigger waves, we seem to want to add a little depth down low because we're into the backstay so much. So, you know, that's one of the tricks here that we're looking at. Rake. Rake is the most important thing on your boat. And getting these to line up correctly is what we're trying to look for. So I've got a little something here from Jarrett Herring in the questions. By the way, I'm going to start taking questions now because you have all heard me talk for the last 25 minutes, and I'm sure you're ready for some other stuff. So Jarrett Herring, as a skipper driving and trimming your main or having designated main trimmer, how much backstay are you playing full throw from complete to full on a smaller changes? So I think what he's getting at is there's two ways here that we're driving the J70. The majority of people out there have a main trimmer and a tactician. Some people are driving their own boat and trimming their own mains. What's good and bad about those two situations? For me, I trim my own main right now. If it gets really breezy or we have some big boat maneuvers like around marks or ducks, I'll hand off the main to my tactician. But for me, it feels really comfortable to have the main sheet in my hand. I can feel the boat load up. I know when to ease, and it feels really nice. Now, the counter argument to that is that there's more to focus on than just driving. And like I said, in bigger breeze, I'm handing my main off so that I can focus on keeping the correct angle of heel. I actually think it's pretty hard in this boat, with all the good sailors out there, to do your own main and to drive your own boat. I think that you may miss, you know, the high-end gear, the fast gear in this boat by not handing off your main. So keeping those guys on their mainsail and trimming it for you is a really good way. I've lucked out being able to trim my own main because it's, you know, going 10 knots, but anything over that, it becomes a bit struggle. I think there's a really good range, a really big range that you're moving your main sheet through with this new sail design. So, you know, that's something I want to hand over to Cam too, because Cam is trimming the main for his driver all the time. And I want to hear about that and why it's such a good thing, not only for the driver, but for the tactician. So Cam, you want to talk a little to that?
Yes, sure. I mean, both have their pros and cons, and each particular situation, probably the best way to speak to it might be is quite often, you know, we go through the tuning guide here, and we all know you're looking and you're trying to work what you before the race, what you feel is going to be your best setting to hit for the race. If you're going to target wanting to be, if you're going to be caught out, you want to be caught out over trimmed on the rig because you think the breeze is going to build, or vice versa, and you don't want to be caught out over, and you know that you can flatten out the sails enough if the breeze builds a little bit, but you don't want to be caught out with not enough power. So when you are, I think, out of tune or out of that range, that's when being on the main yourself, because you have to then make up for that discrepancies in the rig tune with the sails. So, you know, if you're trying to balance out the backstay, but you're getting towards the maximum amount of backstay you can pull without flattening out your main and folding it in half, then are you just going a little bit more vang on, or are you the vice versa, where you're needing to ease the vang to get the power because you don't want to go any further eased on the backstay? And so it's making those adjustments. Often you're easing the main sheet to then adjust another setting, and maybe the main sheet's coming on, but then you want to pull a little bit of backstay on to match it because you're just trying to overall flatten the shape of the sail, but you still want to keep that leech tension. Or are you working the manipulating the sail and the situation based upon what the wind range or the mode's doing at the time? And so, you know, from that point of view, you're often changing the three main controls to travel a little less often, because that's sort of set and forget in a lot of cases, or just very small changes. But I kind of look at it that as a tactician, I get a bit of a better feel for the boat and how the boat's performing, and know where and how I can position the boat based on the way that I know the boat's feeling. Now, you know, the other side with the helmsman doing the main, it means that the tactician has a lot more time to look around and can just check in again. Sorry, that with the helmsman doing the main, the tactician's able to look and really see what's going on the course. But, you know, you're quite often set up in a position that you really have to fight for a lane, and you really want to work that way, and you don't want to have to tack off, or you don't want to, you know, have to make a duck or something. So therefore your tactics are a little bit more limited because it's about holding that particular lane. So then you're adjusting everything and really helping the boat stay in the position that you're set up in. Is that kind of cover enough for you?
Yeah, no, I mean, I think what you answered was great, because what you're essentially saying is that if you're out of tune, here's the reason why you would stay with your tactician doing the main, because you're right. When you're out of tune, there's a lot more adjusting going on back there, and the driver being able to do that. I mean, I know from this question here, talking about the throw of a backstay, how much are we playing it? When we're in windy conditions, we put so much backstay on that the tactician actually will stand up and pull the rest of the backstay on. There's no way as a skipper I can do that. So you think about that, and you think about how many, you know, it's almost a foot of main play that you have. You know, I really think the tactician has a better vantage point to do that in most conditions. So sticking with the traditional tactician mainsail driver, tactician mainsail trimmer is a pretty good way to simplify things for the driver. And that's ultimately, you want to be the most comfortable as a driver. And if you got a whole bunch of stuff going on, it's pretty tough. One thing that we're talking about backstay, and we talked a little bit about rig tune, and we talked about how above base we're actually going 1-to-1 ratios between the lowers and the uppers. That's not only for the depth in the bottom of the main, but that's also for the headstay staying tight. One thing that I've found since we've started going higher clues and more in home is that just can't be too loose on your headstay. So, you know, one way, you know, if you're out of tune, obviously the one way of getting more headstay tension, there's two ways. It's main sheet trim or it's backstay. But if you're tuned correctly, you have enough lowers on and enough uppers on together, and the main sheet and the backstay, that your headstay is super tight and you're able to in-haul. The thing that happens when you don't have enough headstay tension and haul on this boat is that the back end of the sail comes into your mainsail and the front end of the sail drops to leeward and essentially is a brake. It's, you know, it's stalling out the whole time. So you can weather sheet as much as you'd like if you have a loose forestay. So that's why we say at base, we're starting to, you know, double up our lower tension as we go windier to allow us to have more headstay tension, more backstay tension. And when those big puffs hit, we could still ease our mainsail without losing our headstay. So those are something to think about while you're sailing and while you're swimming. That's just not for a quantum thing. That's all the ranges, all the sailmakers. You know, it's not like they got together and discussed this, but I can tell you now looking at pictures and video, everyone's got a pretty straight headstay until you're really searching for that power. And that's, you know, under 10 knots. So 10 knots and more, we're looking for a pretty straight headstay in order to do what we want to do with that weather sheet. So that's some of the insides to how we're sailing. You know, I'll talk a little bit about the driving side of things here. I think these boats, it's funny, I come from a lot of J boats, fortunately, but J24s, pretty hard to sail. J22s, they all have neutral leeward helm. Even this boat is a pretty neutral helm boat and mostly run by, you know, crew positioning and sail trim. So this boat became very tweaky in the last year. And that's why our rig tune is so important. And the sail shapes have now become so important. You have to keep designing sails to make sure you're staying up to date. But at the same time, you want to hone in on that setup and use that for a while. And this is something that we've looked at and making sure that this boat feels correct. So, like I said, this boat's pretty hard as a driver. It's probably one of the hardest boats I've sailed because it's a neutral helm. There's not much feel to it. The boat doesn't load up until you're overpowered after 12 knots of breeze. So, again, that just reiterates why we want to have a good tactician and main trimmer in the same spot. So that's, you know, it's pretty hard for everybody out there, and it makes it a really fun boat to get right. So we're going to move on to the next slide here. I do have one question here from Reed, and about crew position in light air. Are there any signs that my crew may be out of whack? Are you looking at boat speed, point, the sails, etc.? So, Reed, that's an awesome question. We've played around a ton with crew weight. There's two signs. One sign, if you're pointing really high and you just don't have bow down speed, the first thing to check is your crew placement for sure. If your crew placement's really forward and the boat's kind of digging in the bow, sure, you have some ups from that. You may have some height from that. But going on from there, if you can't put the bow down, one, the crew weight aft a little bit. The one thing that we've noticed is that my mainsail trimmer is now always sitting in front of the winch, and everybody is always butted up to him. So that's kind of where we're always at upwind. Maybe they move slightly forward, a body or so forward as it gets lighter. But in the breeze, we want to keep everybody to him, and he's in front of the he's in front of the winch. So yeah, telltale sign that you can't put the bow down and go forward. The first sign is, where's my crew placement? Is it too far forward? Second sign of that would be, is my rig tension correct? So those are two things. Downwind, in displacement mode, we're always pushing forward in the boat. We think that's just it gets the back end of the boat out of the water, less wetted surface, and allows the boat to be flat and go downwind when needed. Obviously, as it gets windier, we all start to stack back. But that brings up another point, is that I think, from what I've seen lately, sometimes people jump the gun on putting a person behind the skipper when you're in a planing condition. If it's lazy plane, you're going to be moving your weight a ton. As it gets lighter, you want the crew to slide forward. As it gets windier, you want the crew to slide back. So I think it's better for everybody to be forward of the skipper until you're really, you know, 18, 20 knots and because they have the opportunity to move forward and aft depending on the breeze changes. So I hope that that helps anything with the crew positioning. And if anybody has any other questions on rig setup, not particularly for our sails, but for anything, we've seen it all lately. So please keep questions coming. Bacardi was a phenomenal event. I was very fortunate enough to sail some great guys, Danny Lawless, Jeff Becker, Andy Horton. And those guys are awesome. It was great. But as a driver, I don't remember much about the event except for the starting line. So what I'm going to do is Cam was calling tactics here, and I want to hand it over to Cam to talk what, you know, he's been down in Miami a ton and what he sees, and especially the direction that we had was very similar to what you see almost every day in Miami. So Cam, do you want to talk about Bacardi? And then we're going to roll into a little bit to get ready for Charleston. So this is kind of your time to shine here.
Yeah, nice work. Well, good. Congrats anyway. Maybe you didn't see anything because you're wiping the champagne out of your eyes from that glorious win you had. Anyway, congrats. You guys sailed brilliantly. And yeah, from a tactical standpoint, it was quite interesting. It was also one of the first events of the year where there was actually some breeze and some fantastic conditions. Sort of brings me back to the old days in in Miami when just conditions were just brilliant. I think a lot of the events got a little bit skunked with not enough wind throughout the beginning half of the year. Miami was tricky on the opening day with a lot of breeze and the first race being quite a short leg. So, you know, I kind of looked at it, I'll just discuss real quickly, like the short leg to the longer legs or more traditional lengths for the size of fleet. But, you know, I looked at it, okay, short leg, what is the longest tack? Where is the favor of the start line? Does that match up with me getting onto the longest board as fast as possible? How can I get there cleanly? Shorter race courses, more boats. You want to start getting yourself to the right a little bit sooner. And so just balancing out how that sort of formula of where I wanted to be, how I looked at it. And then it sort of became more like a training race one, because training races are generally quite short and a lot of congestion at mark. So I looked at that. Then when you go into longer legs, it's about looking at start line bias. Does that get you to the course favored side? How much time do you want to spend on which tack? Where do you want to end your beat? You know, breaking it down into the thirds. There were enough shifts, there always is in Miami, so it's quite key to play those shifts and never sail through a shift if you think it's sort of a longer, persistent shift. Quite often you can go out looking in the left and not find it's working until right at the end. So you always want to get up the leg as fast as you can in that sort of easterly type breeze to do your port as often as you can, play the shifts into the top, set yourself up. There's always big gains to be made on positioning, not getting stacked up on lay lines too soon, all the mistakes that I probably commonly made during that event. But again, just looking at how you want to approach every part of the course, having a plan, be able to adapt it, knowing what some of the keys are and the importances, which will then relate to other racing. So as long as you're prepared, you know what you want to do, and then use all your team to help you. I always set goals with the crew, whether it's be calling the short-term paths or the long-term, or what some of the other boats are looking like around the course, sort of who's doing what, who's positioning where, so that you kind of know, you select your boats that you're around and you want to know how they're performing against you and what they're doing. So basically that's quite kind of one of the keys. Then, you know, Miami, it was, you know, in the all-out planning conditions at the first sort of half of the regatta saw us in, it was about getting a clean lane. So often the jibe set was working well because, A, the person onto that new jibe first had clean, fresh water. They could sail where they weren't, where they wanted. They weren't dictated by other boats trying to sail up and roll them or getting down inside, blocking the jibe. And so you end up sailing your mode, fast into the corner. You choose your time when you want to jibe. You don't get flushed out of, if you're in the chain, you often get flushed out before maybe you're ready because some guy was looking strong on your inside, some guy rolled you. And so there's often, you're looking for clean water and good pressure lanes is really important. So, you know, that was kind of my key takeaways. Then the final event, final day turned into the biggest sort of tactical advantages were between going from the normal standard mode, sailing low, to switching in and out of the wing. And just being able to really adapt the tactics to when that was applied best and what the right pressure or shift was, or where you're just trying to get leverage on the boats around you. So, you know, again, well, you know, just,
I got a question for you.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. And then, yeah. So starting wise in Miami, you know, we talk about how the left side's kind of favored on his easterlies and southeasterlies. What's your take on, do you start at the favored end or do you get to the left from a different spot down there? You know, that I think a lot of people, you know, they always think the favored end is the leeward end, and really only one boat gets out of there. So what's your game plan in Miami when you go to start?
Sure. Well, I often, if I've sailed in a fleet for quite a while, you sort of build a little bit of an understanding of the philosophy and the approach of everyone in the fleet. And that's really important to sort of understand your fleet. Who does what, when, how does a fleet sort of set up? Do they like to set up early? Do they like to set up late? Do they set up far from the line with long starboard approaches? Are there people that come in late on port all the time? All these sort of things. So you build up this awareness of who does what and how the general format of the start unfolds. And yeah, if you think that there's an opportunity to get out of the pin and you're confident in your approach, your timing and your execution, then you go and fight for it. But as you get less confidence or you think there's less importance in that number one spot down there, you slide up the line and you find your sort of soft spot in the line. And so if your goal is to get left, you do whatever you can to start to not have to be tacked off or flushed out. And so, you know, quite often I noticed a lot of the top group of people were really starting in the middle of the line and leaving themselves with the option for both. They weren't, you know, I would say a lot of the top sort of eight didn't really fight overly hard for the pin area. It wasn't generally always favored too. It was only favored probably about a third of the time. Then some of the time the line was quite even, and then there were often three or four starts where there was a little bit of boat favor, or it was shaping up that way and crashed right on the final minute. So you know, it's about looking and getting a bit of a feel for the flow and the dynamics of the fleet is how I look at things. Try and get a bit of an understanding early on what everyone does.
Yeah. No, that's awesome. It's a good point, though. You know, to get left doesn't mean you have to start left. And I think that was one thing that we looked at was, man, the pin's always really crowded, or even the boat end was always really crowded. And it seemed like it was a little looser in the middle. And that's probably where we lived 90% of the time, that regatta. And it seemed to do okay. It gave us options if I messed up a start or not as well. So I got a question for you for starting. As a trimmer, as a jib trimmer, what are your jobs as the jib trimmer on the start? And do you, you know, are you listening to the tactician about when you're going to trim the jib in, or do you have a kind of a schedule of events that you look at that tells you, hey, I've got a trim. I'm the guy that tells you when to go. What do you kind of do at the starting line with the jib?
I think it's a great question. It was one I've been kind of chewing on as you're talking, because my first comment to sort of that hits on this was back to your comment about all the marks on the jib sheets and everything. One of the biggest factors I think that's excellent about that, you know, the new jib and being able to sort of find a mode is with the amount of range we get from the weather sheet, as you spoke about. So one of the things that's starting to touch on your question is that comes with working on, you know, your rapport with the helm and the team. But that's getting a setting for the weather sheet, you know, a preset spot for that weather sheet, maybe as you approach that final dance to the line. You know, you're getting inside that 20 seconds, you're marching. And a lot of times what we worked on was Danny or whoever the bow person was would often kind of have a mark, again, just key to have those marks on that weather sheet in a spot where we knew we were, you know, maybe just slightly more powered, a tiny bit more powered than like full on upwind speed mode to set for that weather sheet so that you're getting a little bit of shape in that sheet, you know, forced in with the weather sheet so that when the gun goes off or we're doing that final countdown, I can kind of sheet into my leeward mark with some confidence and there's power in the sail and we're just hitting zero with the sail really in that sweet spot. So anyway, just one of the comments I'd have on that part of knowing your marks and your setup with the jib, I think is really huge. So that was a big thing that I think is that people should work on is finding that mark. But then, yeah, to answer your question more about the, you know, the timing, I think it always helps when the trimmer has a little bit of a feel for, you know, starting the boat themselves or feeling the power in the boat. But I think it is, I'm always asking, you know, whoever is the driver, just saying, you know, what do you want here? What do you want here? You know, and, you know, do you want full speed? Do you want partial flow? And usually kind of taking a little bit of my own feeling as to what we need and doing that, but just constantly checking in with the driver or maybe someone else who's calling that line, right? Just so I know, boom, I can put the brakes on and kill it a little bit. But I think with this boat, knowing the flow, a lot of things I think we worked on, Trav, when we were sailing was just kind of keeping that like 80% march on where you're just engaging the leech of the jib enough to kind of, you know, to kind of keep a little bit of bite on it. But obviously recognizing you don't want to wail on that sheet too soon, drag your bow down and burn up a leeward hole. So that's kind of the constant communication that I'm thinking about leading into a start.
No, that's really good stuff, especially about the weather sheet, making sure that you have a mark for that, out of the start or out of attack, even, you know, you want to have it set so that you're using that, the weather sheet wants to be on pretty quickly, and maybe not right all the way to it. So making sure you have your marks pretty good. And I guess the one thing as a driver, I'm always constantly talking to the trimmer about, you know, our speed and our speed to the line. And the one thing that I look at is that I don't ever want my boat speed to go below 2.5 knots. So whatever I have to do to keep it about 2.5 to 3 knots so that I never lose flow, we do that. You know, maybe we come out a little early with the jib and you're halfway trimmed in. And that's kind of something that we work on so that we're not always, you know, starting from going 0.1 knots instead. We're starting at 2.5 knots. We've already got flow. We can put the bow down and the boat doesn't slip sideways right away. So that's something that we look at. But anyways, those are all really great points. Thanks, Kris. Thanks, Cam. Moving on to Charleston for all of those that are going to Charleston Race Week. What do we expect from the wacky conditions that we get in Charleston between current, where we're set up on the courses, and, you know, usually a nice sea breeze that comes through there. So Cam, who just did a kind of preview of what Charleston Race Week is going to look like for us at Quantum and all you competitors, is going to kind of take over a little bit and give you a preview of what to expect at Charleston. And we'll have you on your way after this. So, Cam, one more.
Austin's obviously shaping up to be a great event with, I think, is it 36 entries to date? And with everything being situated on Circle 2, many of you have already sailed probably that circle and many times at Charleston, so sort of have an idea what to expect. But many, this might be the first event for the season for you. So I think it's important to, you know, think about the preparation that's needed to put in before arriving. How are you going to manage yourself when you get there? Setting up your training, having your goals in place, and just really understanding the conditions, whether it be the forecast, the tidal flow, and knowing what and how that's going to change and affect that course location and you on any given day based on the forecast. So, you know, some of the sort of the main keys there are, you know, as you're preparing for the regatta, really have a good handle on what effects the tide's going to have for you on each particular leg, how it's going to change, and you have to adapt your plan throughout the course. You know, it affects ley lines, obviously, starting strategies. You know, if it's lighter wind and you're against the current, it takes a little bit longer to get to the line to build speed because your appearance knocked down. You know, if you're coming at marks and you're coming down current, everything's happening a bit sooner, you know, stand side ley lines. All those sort of keys that everyone's really familiar with, but it's just about having everybody on board the boat. As I talked about, I think you rely on everyone. That's the beauty about the J70, is that generally all the four, often there's five people on the boats, have quite a contributing role, whether it's mechanically, but I think more so on a communication standpoint, and just dialing in the communication within teams. I think anyone that hasn't sailed for a while will find just refining how they communicate and what the communication keys need to be, and just tuning in to what those set goals are around the race course is I think really important. So, you know, when you're looking at your objectives for the week, setting your goals, you know, what you're focusing on in the training, you know, whether that's, you know, from a day-to-day point of view, getting out racing, getting your speed dialed in, getting your crew work, getting your starts, and then the rest, your setup, making sure that, as Travis has talked about, your rig tune's all in the right place, you set up to the guide, you understand what those steps are and processes. And then it's just go out and execute it, and obviously have an awful lot of fun. It's going to be a great venue, and I'd say, you know, as always, a fantastic regatta. You know, there's the COVID policies that you all need to abide by and follow in on. But in general, I think, you know, everyone knows how Charleston sets up and knows that, you know, generally the tide rules everything, but not always. There's going to be some points when you'll be at slack water and it's about finding the wind shifts and other times where you're really focused on the tide. So just be open-minded and be ready to adapt. That's sort of my main takeaways.
Excellent. Awesome. I'm looking forward to that regatta. All right. Well, I think we're coming to the end here. We appreciate everybody for being on this call. It was fun to talk about what we've got coming up with us and what we have for regattas to come up. So, you know, we'll see you at Charleston Race Week. We'll see you at Nudes, and we'll see you at J70 North Americans. Any of these guys on the call, Cam, Kris, myself, or any in the introduction that we made with the Holes J70 team are there to answer any of your questions. Feel free to email, call us anytime. We're here to help. So I appreciate everybody being on here. Cam, Kris, thank you very much. And hopefully see you all in Charleston. I think that's it.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks a lot, guys.
Thanks, guys. Take care. All right.